story, wasn't it? What was it, 4 hours and 40 minutes against Aaron Crickstein? And he just goes on and on and on. Would, I wonder, Paul Haarhuis even dare to win today? And I know the atmosphere there as the match goes on, I'm sure will be much like a Merseyside or a Manchester or a Glasgow or even a big cricket final at Lord's. Okay then, Jimmy Connors against Paul Haarhuis. The winner will play Jim Courier in the semi-final. Who's it going to be? Enjoy it with John Barrett.
So, 7:40 here in New York on a lovely summer's evening. Mid-70s, I'd say low 70s perhaps. A perfect evening for tennis, really no wind to speak of. Paul Haarhuis here, unseeded, about to face the test of his young tennis life. Haarhuis, who is 25 and comes from Holland, Eindhoven, playing against a man who is a living legend indeed, as he's proved this year again, Jimmy Connors, the age of 39, astonishing us all with two outstanding matches here this year. In the first round, beating Patrick McEnroe after trailing by two sets to love and love 3, love 40 on his serve, a game he won, and then at 2-3, 15-40 on his serve. Again, he came out of that and finally won the match in the fifth set, 6-4. And then the other night, the unbelievable scenes here as he destroyed the nerve of young Aaron Crickstein and won in a tiebreak in the final set in 4 hours and 41 minutes, the longest match ever played here in the US Championships. And really, the question mark hanging over the head of Jimmy Connors tonight is this. It's a simple one. Yes, he's a much better player than Paul Haarhuis, with a record which I shall be speaking of during the course of the evening, but has that 39-year-old body recovered from the astonishing pounding it was subjected to a couple of days ago when he beat Aaron Crickstein in that memorable match? Ever since, he's been taking a lot of massage. He had an intravenous fluid injection immediately afterwards that same evening. He jogged around the stadium at the grandstand court on the advice of the medics to wind down after that long match. He's had massage and heat treatment on that left knee that was troubling him. He's been practicing with our own John Lloyd, these days a resident of California, who reports that he is in astonishingly good form. And John cannot believe how relaxed and keen and free from physical problems Jimmy Connors is. Well, here's the man who's going to put those limbs to the test. Paul Haarhuis, who many of you at home may know only vaguely. You may remember that a couple of years ago on this very court he beat one John McEnroe, and that astonished everybody. And every now and again he does produce these extraordinary wins. And when I tell you that Paul Haarhuis here this year has only ever reached one semi-final of a tournament, you will understand what an astonishing achievement it is that he's done here. Let's look at Jimmy Connors then, 39, ranked 174 in the world, and a wild card entry here, and all those extraordinary championships. Australia 74, the French he's never won, Wimbledon twice and five times here. And to reach this quarter-final, the match I spoke of against Patrick McEnroe, and then Michael Schepers, also of Holland, Karol Novacek of Czechoslovakia, and that epic against Crickstein in the fourth round. So Jimmy Connors, with the support of 20,000 fans here, minus a few who will surely be shouting for this fellow, is going to try what would seem at first sight to be impossible, to win against a younger man who is playing the tournament of his life. 26 years of age, ranking in the world of 45. He has been as high as 36. And that year when he beat McEnroe here, reaching the fourth round at this Open. But to reach this quarterfinal, he's beaten Yellen of Germany, 6-2 in the fifth. Chesnikov of the Soviet Union, 7-6 in the fourth, and then two straight sets wins against the German Davis Cup team, knocked him out, or at least part of the German Davis Cup team, Becker and Stabe. And really, it has been an astonishing tournament for both men in their own ways. And what a setting for this battle between the man who everybody looks to as the epitome of Britishness and the epitome of the fighter, the street fighter, Jimmy Connors, who at times, it must be said, goes beyond the limits. And I've thought once or twice that umpires have not really applied the rules properly and fairly. They've subjected themselves, or they've been subjected to abuse which they should really have dealt with and didn't. So, all ready for the start of what should be a fascinating confrontation, a first confrontation between Connors, who will serve, and Haarhuis. And I understand that at home you may not be hearing the court effects, the sound of ball on racket. We must apologize for this and hope that our friends here with the CBS network can sort it out for us. I don't care what you say, this man has to be feeling stiff and a little bit sore after 4 hours and 41 minutes the other day. So the first 3 points have gone against him. And I don't think Haarhuis is going to be at all nervous about winning this match. And I believe as the first game ends with a break of the Connors served by Haarhuis, we have the sound back. So not altogether surprising that Jimmy Connors should have been broken in the opening game. It is going to take him a while to get those limbs functioning again and to get the touch and feel on the racket face. And Haarhuis here will be trying to remain calm in the face of what is sure to be fervent support for Connors from this huge crowd. It was impossible today to find anybody who had spare tickets for this match, perhaps the most eagerly awaited performance, because that is what Jimmy Connors provides every time he plays of these championships.
White beans.
Six behind the plate. Haarhuis then, one love. So Connors' first point greeted with undue applause. Haarhuis getting the first taste of what that crowd can do. Yes, I wasn't far wrong in my estimate. I've just been handed a slip of paper with the temperature on it. It is 77 degrees tonight, a lovely temperature after all that we've been through, and 62% humidity, which is really pretty good for New York. Well, now, Jimmy... worried. Oh, yes. Bruno Rabot, the French umpire, just making the usual request for no flash photography. One of the big problems for Connors tonight is to get himself emotionally charged up again against a man who really is almost faceless, in the sense that he's unknown to, I'm sure, most American viewers and indeed the public here. And really, a string of errors from the Connors racket so far. And Haarhuis, a simple two-love lead. But don't be fooled by that slow start. I'm sure that most of us expected to see something like that at the beginning of the match as the crowd try to rouse Connors to some sort of form. Incidentally, talking of flash photography, I thought last night, watching the Ländl-Stick match that was interrupted, that was a great deal of flash photography, which was all rather annoying. About an hour and a half ago, a little more than that now, Jimmy Connors was out here on this court with John Lloyd, who's been his regular hitting partner this championship. Well, a bit like a bullfight, this, isn't it? With the matador charging in and thrusting the sword home down the line there. Love two, 15 all, first set. Paul Haarhuis will certainly be tested in the temperament department tonight with this already well-roused crowd. Thank you. But I think he will pass all those tests.
Oh.
Hasn't got the range yet. Haarhuis taking his time beautifully. No appeal, he thought about it. Of course, the crowd want to see every shot Connors hits go for a winner. A point for three love. What a lovely return. Perfectly flighted to stretch Connors on the backhand side, the two-hander. And three love with two breaks. Haarhuis leads in the first set. So the sort of start that you dream of when you're playing a legend like Jimmy Connors. But I'm sure Paul Haarhuis has been carefully advised by Stan Franker, who for a couple of, well, for about 3 years now, has been guiding the fortunes of all the Dutch players as the national coach. Came on from a job in Austria where he was doing just the same, and in fact he, I think, has been the sort of catalyst for this marvellous surge in the standard of so many of the Dutch players. Jan Siemerink, a colleague of Haarhuis here, is another young Dutchman who has distinguished himself. And I'm sure Franke will have told him, well, you may get an easy start because Jimmy will be stiff and tired, but he will, as he gets into the match, become better and better. And I'm afraid that is what, from Haarhuis' point of view, the danger is. Well, all too easy for Haarhuis at the moment. That could be another danger. Ooh. I'm sure that Jimmy Connors doesn't want this to be the biggest anti-climax of all time, so great are the expectations of the crowd here, indeed the whole American nation. The purple prose in the New York papers was wonderful to behold the day after the Krikstein match. Oh. So Connors has won just 1 point against the Haarhuis serve. Perhaps a change of rackets will bring a change of luck.
Like these. Thank you.
You could almost see him trying to get his mind into this match. Get himself emotionally involved in it.
15
London. Haarhuis plays in very much the modern style with a semi-Western forehand grip. The hand half under the handle, the palm rather half under the handle, and then two-handed on the backhand, as so many of today's younger players do. And it does mean that the ball is going to kick up awkwardly off a good length. John Lloyd there, you may have caught a sight of him in the bottom right-hand corner of the picture. Jimmy's sparring partner. Well, that was a pretty darn good deep approach and a fine stop volley. Catching Connors a little bit slow off the mark there. And I think the roar that greets the winning backhand is more in hope than anything else, hope of a revival. And it was a good backhand, hit with his customary fire, taken early. But it remains to be seen whether the legs will really function properly. Still in second gear, Jimmy Connors. Well, a wonderful moment for him to bring this crowd really to life. With his first successful running pass, 14, he has to make 13. A lot of ground here. Haarhuis hanging back just a little bit. Here he goes, and how often we saw this the other night and heard. Heard the crowd erupting.
White, please. Thank you.
Now, if he wins his first game here, I think you'll really hear a roar. And he has. Well, at least Connor seems to be in good humour. His first game, but Haarhuis 4-1. So, Haarhuis feeling the full effect now of the crowd's roar, but I don't think he'll be upset by that, frankly. He played jolly well the other night against Stave, the other day against Stave. And not to lose one set against Becker and Stave combined, well, really, that was some performance. Connors sweating more freely now and perhaps beginning at last the body to feel a little bit more part of the match. There's a terrible feeling of stiffness and soreness when you've had a really very long match. And he's had two, separated, it's true, by many days, because the match against Patrick McEnroe was in the first round. And then he had his two straight sets wins over Sharpers and Novacek, but nevertheless, that punishing outing against Krikstein had to leave its mark. The unforced errors there, 11 of them, hurting his cause at the moment. But then it was the same story early on against Krikstein. I seem to remember 17 unforced errors in the first seven games.
Ladies and gentlemen, one, please. Ready for play? Thank you.
The voice of Bruno Rabot, who lives in the south of France, trying to quieten the crowd. 4-1 Haarhuis. Not a very fast server, but he does vary it well, Haarhuis. Well, he hasn't dropped many balls half court like that for Connors really to get hold of, as at last he does, and that will be a warning to him to keep the ball deep. 30-15. Yes, still the unforced errors hurting the Connors cause. And it's more a mental thing than anything else, really. Arthur Ashe and his wife there watching with keen interest. Oh, I say. Nothing serious, I think. It was just a slip. I thought he'd twisted his ankle for a moment, but I don't think so. Let's have another look at that. Now, here he goes. He just seemed to stumble rather awkwardly. There it was. Well, it was the right ankle, wasn't it? It did seem to go over, seeing it from the side there. But no sign of any discomfort. 1-5. Surprising Connors, as he surprised Boris Becker with the accuracy of this forehand, which is rather a slap at times, rather wristy, but it's entirely natural. And all that matters is it works. So very keen. Very keen Dutch camp there watching the whole proceedings. When your opponent is making a lot of unforced errors like this, the percentage thing is just to go on playing consistently, as Haarhuis has been so far, keeping a good length and not trying for too much.
Torino.
One, five, 30 all, first set.
Is this good here? Is this called good here?
Well, I don't know what Jimmy Connors is worrying about.
Huh?
Well, either Jimmy Connors has lost track of the score genuinely to the amusement of Bruno, or it was just a little device to get his breath back. You never know with Connors whether it's a little bit of quiet gamesmanship. Well, I wish I'd counted the strokes in that rally. Must have been approaching 30, ending with a wonderfully accurate Connors forehand, typical of the man down the line, the middle of the rally containing some beautifully deep driving. And Haarhuis just unable to move quickly enough to that corner. But he shouldn't mind a long rally like that, Haarhuis. At his age, 25 rather. And Connors clinging on marvellously at a dangerous moment to keep himself in this set, 5-2 to Haarhuis in the first set. Back. 89% of the first serves that do go in, and he's getting about two-thirds of them in, so that's pretty good. A lot of them, it's true, unforced errors from Connors. Serving now for the first set, then, for Haarhuis. Good lob that, because it was a defensive one and very high, which it should have been. That's exactly the way to play defensive lobs. Never easy to smash a ball falling vertically. And you sense that Connors here is trying to exert just a little bit of pressure now on Haarhuis. Wow. signs that Haarhuis is beginning to tighten up just a little bit. The first break points Connors has held.
Quite pleased.
He'd only lost 2 points in three service games before this one. Well, no wonder they're cheering, because that was a masterly rally. The last thing Haarhuis expected here was to see Connors come in and volley it from mid-court, but look at the control and the accuracy. So the first break greeted with roars of approval. And Connors beginning to conduct this crowd once again. Ominously for Haarhuis, it begins to look as if Connors has run most of the stiffness out of those limbs. He's certainly moving a lot better now. That's the area that he has to attend to, the unforced errors. John Lloyd. Three, five, and 15 all. Fascinating situation this, because Connors, I think, realizing that a really long match is probably beyond him after what went on the other day against Crickstein. Despite trailing 1-4 and then 1-5, has decided to make a go for it in this set. And banking on the fact that his less experienced opponent will begin to choke under the pressure, the expectation of winning the set. Certainly that's what happened on Haarhuis's service game just now. And Connors beginning now to find something like normal form. Haarhuis, though, 5-4 in the first set. So Jimmy Connors is an amazing man, isn't he? He's really now, I think, run that stiffness out, because that is exactly what happens when you come out after the experiences of the past few days that he's been through. You do feel stiff and sore and tired, but after a few games you begin to lose it. Now for Haarhuis, the problem is to remain focused in the face of this enormous emotional support that you can almost reach out and touch from the crowd. He's got to combat that, shut it out of his mind, tell himself to play normally and just play a normal service game here. The unforced errors not increasing very much in the past two or three games. It was 11 two games ago. Only two more, Connors. And Haarhuis, remember, growing.
White please. The yells already. Thank you.
Serving for the set for the second time, Haarhuis. He lost his serve to 15 just now at 5-2. Here's the second chance. Well, this crowd noise could become a problem for Bruno Rabeau, because he must see that this man is treated fairly, and certainly if they're going to start clapping and applauding when he serves a normal fault. Well, no noise that time, thank goodness, then he'll have to take action. There's a sign of nerves.
15.
Haarhuis not moving his feet at all in attempting to play that forehand, and that's all nerves.
White please. Thank you.
Altogether better serve here. 6'2" he stands, and hits a fairly consistent first serve, though not a very powerful one. There's the man on the line with Cyclops, the magic eye. Well, now we've reached perhaps the most crucial point in the match for both men. Haarhuis had that 4-love and 5-1 lead. Failed on his serve at 5-2. Now at 30-all, if Connors can pinch this and break again, Haarhuis will find it awfully difficult to mount a charge again. But if Haarhuis can close it out, then Connors may be gone. That's a wonderful shot. That is a truly wonderful shot. And that Bruno is not going to be fooled by the acting from Connors. Connors playing to the crowd here, trying to pretend that he thought the ball was out. Look at it for yourselves. Now, this is the most beautifully struck and courageous forehand. Right in the corner. Set point. That's it. Haarhuis has won the first set. a set of intriguing changes of fortune. 40 minutes, almost 41 minutes it's taken, but the Dutchman now, I would think, has this match for the winning. It's a tired Connors who has bravely come back, and had he won that game, he might well have pinched the match in straight sets. I think now I would expect to see Haarhuis win. He's going to try everything tonight. Haarhuis will be prepared for it, though. I'm sure he's been told by Stan Franke to expect anything to happen. Here he goes. Conducting the orchestra. Going to be long. Together, better start. Connors winning his serve to Love to open the second set. Well, he's given them so much to cheer over the years.
Thank you.
His five titles here, and not here, all of them, because some were at Forest Hills. And it's been such a long and distinguished career that you can never really write him off, but it would be a miracle now if he could come back. A miracle because of the sheer physical demands. Jimmy Connors playing here in only his 10th tournament of 1991. He's played a pretty light schedule. Yes, he'll have to watch that, because Haarhuis is a damn good mover. He really is. And read the little drop volley very early in the piece and set off quickly, which is the secret of all those apparently wonderful gets. Starting early, getting off the mark quickly. There it is again, that lovely natural forehand. 14. It was a shot that really dismayed Becker on so many occasions. Because it's difficult to pick where it's going, it's so wristy. The last minute he can flick it across court. And in theory, he won't mind how long this match goes on and how long the rallies are. In fact, he'll be rather glad to see long rallies, knowing that every passing minute must make life more difficult and the task more difficult for Connors here. One all. Wonderful depth again. That's exactly what Bjorn Borg used to do to drive his opponents mad. Heavily topped, looping drives to the baseline that kicked up like a mule. Awfully difficult when they're that deep to control the ball. So the lights glowing over the city, but most of the public attention on this match right here. And again, the aggression that they came to see is beginning to be evident again in Connors. It was a tame start with great improvement towards the end of that first set, but it's an improvement he must maintain if he's to stand a chance of turning this match around. 30-15. Rather rushed himself, Haarhuis there. Connors given an easy game to take a 2-1 lead in the second set. So far, so good in this set for Connors. But the difficulty of maintaining that sort of level of play over what must now for him be another 3 sets, if he's going to win at least, is considerable. Though one has to say he's astonished us before on so many occasions. I had totally written him off in that third set against Krikstein, and indeed in the third set against Patrick McEnroe, who must now be kicking himself because he had the best chance really of winning. A better chance than Krikstein, I think, even though Krikstein served for it in the final set.
Please, ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
It was that 2 sets to love, 3 love, and love 40 on Connors served moment that afterwards Patrick McEnroe acknowledged to be the turning point. He said, believe that he'd already won, and that is fatal.
Wiper is ready to play. Thank you. White, please. Wipers.
Connors, I think, has probably picked up the wrong racket. Yes. Easily done. And I don't think that was anything to do with gamesmanship. Too many of these long rallies have ended in unforced errors from Connors for comfort. Querying there, Haarhuis, whether Cyclops, the magic eye guarding the service line, is switched on and working. I think it is. Well, there was a ball in the middle of this rally, earlier than this point of the rally, a fine smash, incidentally, to finish, that surprised me. I thought Connors hit a ball long at the far end, and I think Haarhuis thought so too, because he was slow off the mark to the next ball.
30-15.
A 98 miles per hour first ace from Haarhuis. Two all, second set, and Connors really reaching rather vainly for that wide backhand, not getting the feet going. It's a telltale sign of fatigue. That'll do it. Well, he has to dive for this pass and does control it beautifully. Why this match is so intriguing is because there's no doubt that Connors is a far better player. His record speaks for itself. and his performance against the quality of the shots he was hitting against Krikstein were just unbelievable at the end. But Haarhuis, a man fast improving, who's done nothing at all this year except reach one semi-final in Rotterdam, has suddenly hit a golden patch. Easily done that, lacking the extra step that would have made it an easy volley. And Haarhuis, having hit this golden streak and reached his first ever quarter-final in a Grand Slam, may yet be able to beat, and I think will, a man who's very much better than he is, really. As long as he can keep his head. And that is the perfect way to deal with a net rusher who isn't really happy playing that kind of game, though one has to say that the other day against Krikstein, he turned himself into a serve volleyer at times and was charging in so often and making winning volleys. Rather like that. So roars of applause for Connors with his 3-2 lead in the second set. Well, he is such a clever and subtle match player, Connors, full of all the tricks, and I'm convinced that part of the performance the other night with the leg and the limp, the left knee and the limp, was a form of gamesmanship and a variety of other things lead me to think that there really wasn't very much wrong with that leg, if anything. There may have been a twinge or two, but he played it up and hammed it up for all it was worth, and it destroyed Krikstein's concentration. Time. So that is the sort of thing which Haarhuis has got to guard against. And there's no knowing what trick he's going to pull next.
White, please. White, please, thank you.
So Haarhuis is serving in the second set, falling off, only getting 44% of first serves.
White, please. Thank you.
Just an hour.
White, please. Thank you.
Those were the early taken returns that he contrived in the closing stages to unsettle Krikstein. Jimmy Connors playing his 17th quarter-final at a US Open. And you know, over the years, he's reached the quarter-final round in 33 of the 34 Grand Slam events he's played, which is remarkable.
Thank you.
18. Well, as long as those aren't finding their mark, Haarhuis will be safe. Once they do, and he starts threading a few passes out of reach, well, then the crowd will take over, and Haarhuis will again be intimidated. Rather rushed that return. So three games all. No breaks of serve in this set. And in fact, no game tonight from the start of the match to this present point has gone to deuce. And a view from alongside the floodlights atop the high stands here at Flushing Meadow, the Louis Armstrong Stadium. Former football stadium, converted in 1977 and opened in 1978. Donald Trump is often a visitor here, trying to forget some of his financial worries. Usually has a telephone to his ear. No deals doing tonight. Connor's at his best when he's dictating the control, dictating the pace of the rallies. And he was in command of that from the very first shot, from the serve. Well, not a spare seat was to be had for this evening's match. And small wonder, after all Jimmy has achieved so far in this tournament. Well, if you were watching on Sky Sports that first match against Patrick McEnroe, you may remember that marvellous moment when somebody in the crowd yelled, "Carlos!" And he waited for exactly the right moment till everything had quietened down. And so, and then at the top of his voice shouted, "What?" Marvellous moment. That curious spider-like movement. That's going to be out. Haarhuis not working hard enough on that point. No footwork. 4-3. Connors lead, second set.
Connors lead by 4 games to 3, second set.
So Jimmy Connors keeping the crowds happy thus far, with that wonderful surge from 1-4 in the first set and then 1-5 to 4-5, but couldn't quite win that vital point at 30 all on Haarhuis serve. If he'd done that well, we might be telling a very different tale right now. As it is, Haarhuis serving well enough to embarrass one of the best returners of the serve. It's been my pleasure to watch, Thomas. But there is just that little edge missing from his footwork and timing tonight, particularly on the returns of serve. And that's cost him dear. Because when he's playing normally well, his normal form, it is in that department that he excels. Generating the momentum in the rallies from the very first shot, the return. Very sensible to change the shirt. Temperature mid-70s and not too humid. So still Connors well ahead in the unforced errors. But fewer of late. Most of those occurred early on.
Ready for play, thank you. White please, players are ready. Thank you.
3-4. Well, he senses that this is the moment to pounce. Superb angle he found. But on a good day, those would have been returned with interest. Second ace at 112 mph. Respectably fast, though we've had serves in the mid-120s. In fact, the fastest serve, I think, has been delivered by Michael Stick. Well, for the supporters of this man, that was rather an anxious forehand. Normally his best shot. Well, I must say that is not good news for Connors, because he built a half chance on that opening point and then missed the next return. It was the second point of that last game which was so crucial. Love 30, 3-4 Haarhuis would have been rather different. Still no game has gone to deuce, 4-4 second set. Thank you. Well, they thought that this extraordinarily clever backhand smash was going to win him the point, but not a bit of it. The speed, the pace of Haarhuis's reply too much. So he's lost the first point of his last two service games. Oh dear. Not a happy omen, that. Steering it rather than hitting it. Oh, good judgment. And a good approach, forcing the error. Well, three virtual set points. Pancho Segura, one of the craftiest and cleverest of match players, who used to advise Jimmy when he first went to California as a young man. Here we go. The great entertainer, but think of the effect it has on Haarhuis, trying to maintain his concentration. Three break points. Yes, there it goes, the first break of serve in the second set. Connors looking a little bit weary as Haarhuis takes his 5-4 lead. Well, they'll cheer, they'll clap, they'll shout, they'll do anything permissible and not permissible, this New York sports crowd, so used to shouting for their heroes on the football field or the baseball diamond. Serving for the set, 5-4 Haarhuis. First double fault is served. 15-0. And in view of all the applause there has been and the cat calls when he served the first fault, it surprises me that that is the first double fault. Marvellous tennis from Haarhuis. Keeping the ball so deep. And that fizzing topspin. Well, now there was a vintage Connors return, catching Haarhuis this time by surprise, by its depth. Well, this is another really great return of serve at full stretch too, and finding again that same inspiration that we saw the other night. What an extraordinary rally. Well, listen to this. Five times Haarhuis really should have won the point. Connors defending for all he's worth, tossing the ball high. Haarhuis making the mistake of not going for the angle. And when he did, Connors was ready for it. The rally, probably, of the whole championship. Certainly in the context...
Game Connors, five games tall. Point, please.
In the context of being a break point to save the second set.
Thank you. Point, please. Ready for play. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. Point, please.
Well, it's all happening again. I can hardly believe it.
Thank you.
And it remains to be seen what effect it has on this man. That always gets a round of applause. Not as difficult as it looks. That's the way. Make him play it at your pace. I must say, I do feel rather sorry for Haarhuis, as I did the other night for Krikstein, because they haven't come to see anything but a performance from Connors. And he's turning it on again for them. What a remarkable man. And to maintain your poise and concentration through this din and... just not easy. Connors freely acknowledging after that win against Krikstein what a tremendous part of it was due to the support of this huge New York crowd, who over the years have seen the triumphs and disasters of Connors, who incidentally has lost at this stage the quarterfinal for the last 2 years here, both times to Andre Agassi. He's just called long, and Haarhuis looking anxious about it.
Thank you.
I think this is beginning to get to him, this din. And that is the first Connor's double fault today. Good, I think. Connors is certainly taking it and moves 6-5 ahead now in this dramatic second set.
Connors leads 6-5.
Well, what can you say about Connors that hasn't already been said? Every time you write him off, he makes a monkey out of you. And certainly, I, for one, had thought he would lose this set when Haarhuis served for it just now. But it was then that he produced his very best tennis. And I suppose it would not be impossible, if Haarhuis continues to be affected by this extraordinary atmosphere, it would not be impossible for Connors yet to make me an even bigger monkey by winning the match.
Time. Sit with you, please, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you. So
Connors still making many more unforced errors, and this is the moment he must cut them out if he's going to break to take this set and level. All the pressure back now on Haarhuis. Oh, that's a great volley. It was a fine shot, looking at it from the other end from Connors, and it was a magnificent volley, this, to such an acute angle. If it had been any less good, Connors would, I'm sure, have been there in time to hit his winner. A third ace from Haarhuis. Well, that's good serving. And Haarhuis wondering why on earth he wasn't able to do that just now when he was serving for the set, leading 5-4. But that's life. First point of a tie break, all was crucial. Collins perhaps instinctively knowing that he now must force this man to make winning passes and winning shots. Makes him wait a little too. Sure, part of that mishit on the backhand just now, due to the noise the public makes between the first and second serves like this, it really is most unsporting. Well played.
2-1.
That lovely natural forehand of his. Well, Bruno Ribot actually appealing for that very thing, which really is deplorable. Slender lead, the 2-love lead that he held, soon wiped out. Coming to the net again on that very fine cross-court forehand and killing the smash. Good footwork there, getting under the falling ball so that he can go sideways and then kill it. One break point apiece. Haarhuis 2-3. Yes, those are the worrying errors for the supporters of Connors, because they're bread and butter shots, there's no pressure. And I'm sure it's as much a matter of concentration and the effects, the mental effects of that draining match against Krikstein as anything else. That was an important point for Connors to win, my goodness. And they both know it.
5-3, Haarhuis.
What an ordeal. Essential for Haarhuis to win this point, to break back at once. Played it too carefully. And Connors again, controlling the whole situation. Three set points to him. And there it goes, once at all.
Seven against the six, once at all.
Well, that is an amazing effort from Jimmy Connors. Hard to believe seeing him charging around again now. A, that he's 39, had his birthday the other day on the 2nd, and also that he played 4 hours and 41 minutes a couple of days ago. Really, quite remarkable. Sending the boy off with a racket and some gut to have it restrung. Probably that's the frame he likes. And Haarhuis, well, he must now know exactly how the Christians felt in ancient Rome when they were thrown to the lions. With the crowd baying for his blood, it's a rather cruel form of sport, this, for a man
close the gates, please. Thank you.
Playing Connors on the stadium court at Flushing Meadow.
Time.
Well, there's the applause starting up again as both men move to their positions for the start of what should be a cracking third set now, because Haarhuis clearly got just a little bit nervous as the drama developed in the second set. One set all. An hour and 36 minutes, those two sets took. Haarhuis to start the third. Oh, that's brilliant. I think perhaps Haarhuis is going to have to come to the net just a little bit more than he's been doing and dare Connors to pass him. It's a fourth ace. And a fifth.
40.
Soon as the tension's gone, he performs well again.
Fifteen.
What a wild one that was. Well, what a couple of gifts there for him.
Deuce.
And look at this footwork. Wonderful physique for a man of 39, in great shape. Well, this may be a crucial turning point of the match, looked at from Haarhuis's end. Forced into error there, trying to play too delicate a ball down the line. As Commerce charges in, this might be a turning point in the match, because Haarhuis has cracked mentally from 40 love, two aces. He's given Commerce this chance to break him. Well played. Well, Haarhuis did well to come out of that. He really did, saving the break point. And that game is the first one that's gone past deuce. New shoes have arrived for Connors as Haarhuis takes a one love lead in the third. Well, so vital for Haarhuis to have held his serve there. If he'd served two aces as he had and then lost his serve, it would have been from 40 love too, it would have been more than annoying, it would have been really a rather serious blow to his whole confidence level. Connor's changing his shoes, keeping his feet fresh. He did this the other day against Krikstein, and I think that's all it is, to try and keep those weary feet a little fresh. What with Haarhuis and young Richard Krajicek, about 19 years old, who's one of the best servers in the game already, and Jan Siemerink, not to mention Michael Schaefer's, the Dutch really do have a crop of fine players, all challenging one another. That's the joy of it. And pushing one another ever higher. Looking there at the service percentages, Haarhuis was serving at about 65% earlier. Connors has picked up a little, nearly 50, and has done better when he's got his first serve in than in the early part of the match, when he was only winning about 40%. But how long can Jimmy Connors go on calling on the reserves of mental and physical energy at the age of 39 on a hot but pleasant evening here in New York?
15.
That is the question. And one wonders what's going on inside his head. Does he really believe he's good enough to beat this legend? Because if he doesn't, he's not going to. And the sort of spectacular running pass which so dismayed Krikstein in the closing stages. Connors certainly dictating the match at the moment. Almost breaking Haarhuis in the previous game, keeping up his dialogue with the fans to keep him happy. Go home to his wife tonight and say, you know what Connors said to me there in the third set?
Five points, thank you.
One all, third set.
First service.
Well, we've seen that one many, many times. He sees himself as an entertainer, does Connors? Well, now, he was here last time, was Haarhuis, in his previous service game, 40 love, then lost his concentration rather badly. So an easy service game this time for the Dutchman, who leads 2-1 in the third set. In New York, and I can assure you that in hundreds of bars all over the city, the television sets will be on and people will be leaning on the bar, looking at the television and making wise remarks about the likely outcome of this match and rooting, of course, for their hero, Jimmy Connors. Haarhuis here will try and disappoint them all. I can imagine the scene at Runyon's tonight, the lovely little New York restaurant where we usually eat when we're here. They'll all be discussing this one.
Oh. Lopsy.
Well, a little bit of luck here for Haarhuis, giving him plenty of time to pick his pass. I think the problem now for Connors is somehow to keep this momentum going that he created by winning the second set. It's rather dropped away at the moment. He's got to build it up again. I mean, you can't play at breakneck pace all the time. And really, the last thing he can afford to do is to give away those easy points. He's got to make Connors work for everything and try and drain the energy out of those 39-year-old legs again. And perhaps that's what Haarhuis must do a little more. Take a bit of a risk with a forcing return of serve now and again. Connors given an easy smash there, which in fact turned into a volley because the lob was very much too low. When you're in this position, it has to be a very high defensive lob so that you can recover your court position. Connors produced one early in the match that was a gem or a high lob. Well, it is astonishing, this, it really is. The quality of his shot making is wonderful to behold. Beautiful length, and this off forehand now for the winner into the gap that he's created. Like a game of chess, moving his men about to outmaneuver the opposition and then pouncing. Of course, earlier he was making too many errors. And there's a certain brittleness now about Haarhuis. A state of mind probably produced by this very emotional reaction of the crowd and noisy reaction of the crowd. It was almost the perfect half-volley drop shot, one of the toughest shots in the game to play. You'll see it again as he goes in here. Here it is. He has to play a half-volley, but it's just too deep for him. And then a little bit of acting to get his breath back, delaying things. It's good serve. A well served twice. With ace number seven, Haarhuis moves ahead 3-2 in the third set. So the fascination remains. Can Haarhuis believe in himself enough to convert this slender lead now into a winning one? And then, when the moment comes, take his win? Or will the whole occasion be too much for him? Will Connors here conduct the crowd like an orchestra leader?
I'm damn glad to be here.
And make it another sensational evening for his many fans. Certainly nothing in this man's past history would lead you to believe that he has the ability to win tonight, because he's really not got the sort of record which suggests it. He's ranking in the world is way below some of the better quarterfinalists, ahead of Connors, it's true, but only because Connors is really playing at half time, half pace now. 45, Haarhuis is. And the only titles he's won in his life are doubles titles. Two of them this year with Mark Kovelmans and David's. But he's never won a singles title on the tour. And it remains to be seen whether he will go on improving. He certainly had a wonderful US Open. No one will ever take that away from him, win or lose today. Exactly 2 hours. Frankly, Connors is pacing himself quite beautifully at this stage of the match.
Oh.
Not too serious, I think, the second double fault. 40 love. Keeping the ball beautifully low on that pass. And the approach shot really not deep enough. So no breaks of serve in the third set.
Thank you.
And increasingly it's becoming clear that this third set will be a crucial one for both of them.
15.
I don't think there was much wrong with that serve. Bruno Rabot certainly didn't think so. His eighth ace. Well, he served well in this game, I have to say, as Haarhuis, who's had, as I say, a really indifferent season. Second round of the Australian, it was Camporese who beat him there. Well played. Probably his best service game. Just when he needed it, the crucial seventh game, and Haarhuis ahead 4-3. But he's had really, as I say, an indifferent season. The second round of the Australian. Third round in Paris, Todd Martin beat him there in four sets, the American. And at Wimbledon, he lost in the first round to Magnus Larsson of Sweden.
I haven't figured it out yet, Mark.
And the only win he's had was not on the tour, on the main men's tour. It was a challenger tournament. And that in Lagos, he had to go out there to do it, beat the Nigerian champion Nduka Odizor in the semi-final, and went on to win the tournament. But apart from that, it's really been sort of second rounds, first rounds, and the one semi-final in Rotterdam, where he did beat Svensson, Gustafsson and Bergstrom, who have all actually had good season, so there was that one glimmer. But it hasn't been for lack of trying. He's had a couple of wins over Ivan Isevich, who's also had an indifferent season, so there's not much comfort there. And he's playing Haarhuis in his 22nd tournament of the year, so he's working hard. 25 net points won by Connors and 12 by Haarhuis. Well, there's an extraordinary fact. Well, when they move in 1995, if they move, then if the new site is built, I hope they do design the new stadium with the walkways on the outside. This is easily the worst of the Grand Slam sites, and the American Tennis Association very conscious of that fact. And I think the Americans like to be first in everything, so they're going to, they hope to build on a site adjacent to this one, on the 31 acres that they hope the City of New York will allot to them. The last word in tennis stadia. It's going to cost $150 million. Quite an extravagant shot, that last, from Connors. Good, these floodlights here, they really are some of the best anywhere. Casting four clear shadows. So Connors, alive to the danger, moves in behind that ball because he knows that the best that Haarhuis can do is to scoop it up somewhere on a simple winning volley. Well, now he's really charging himself up again. This is where Haarhuis is going to be tested. Last service game, remember, won to Love. Well, Connors really, when he's fired up in this mood, it's like playing two people. Beautifully struck. Back live. And missing with his backhand. And the local network covering this USA. Bringing us these pictures with the aid of our CBS friends and cameramen. Fine pictures they are too. So Haarhuis doing what Connors did earlier, catching the ball on his racket. That was a risky shot. Well, Connors is the lucky one here. He's playing one opponent. Haarhuis is playing 20,001. It really is quite astonishing how you keep your head as an opponent of Connors in these circumstances. I simply do not know. It was a wonderful return of serve to set up that easy smash, and the leap in those legs still. Look at this. Well, he's going to try and milk this one and get the crowd going. 112 miles an hour, ace number 9. But he's making Haarhuis wait, getting the crowd to take a part in affairs again. And it's still a break point. Well, now a muff to add to the interruption for Haarhuis. There's the break, and small wonder, Connors 5-4, third set.
Connors leads 5-4, third set.
You know, the machine seriously misses and goes like this far. But I mean, if it's not working, just let the man call it himself.
He's worried about the line monitor. At least that's the way he's directing Rubo's attention, Bruno Rabot, the umpire. And all the while, the wretched Haarhuis has to put up with this din created by this gentleman here. Well, gentlemen, perhaps that's not always the right word, but certainly a great entertainer, a fine shot maker, and a man who fights to the last gasp. Where does it all come from? The adrenaline must now surely be pumping with this break of serve, attempting to go 2-1 ahead. And I must say, when Haarhuis led by a set and 5-4 serving, I really thought Connors' chances had gone. But as so often in the past, he's proved us wrong.
Ladies and gentlemen, quite is ready for play. Ready for play, thank you. Quite please. Thank you.
But it is incredible how he can find the shots at exactly the right moment. He did exactly this against Krikstein. And you'll remember how many unforced errors he's hit. But not when it matters.
Five minutes. Thank you.
Astonishing.
49.
3 set points.
5 minutes. deficit. Wait, please.
Well, there seems to have been a disturbance in the crowd here. Somebody refusing to stop calling out, and I think he'll be removed. There's obviously a heated argument going on there. Jimmy enjoying it all. And one can only feel very sorry for this man.
Players are ready. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Like playing in a bear garden.
Figure out what's going on.
So the stewards trying to get everything sorted out and quietened down. But that's New York, isn't it?
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you. That's it. He's 2 sets to 1 ahead.
Canales leads by 2 sets to 1.
So after 2 hours and 20 minutes, their wishes have been fulfilled. Jimmy Connors has done it for them again. 2 sets to 1. He leads against all the odds, against a man who really should have led by 2 sets to love, and who now must be wondering what on earth he's doing out here in this madhouse. Well, the combatants in the stands seem to have sorted out their differences. Or have they? Well, I think we'll all be quiet again in a minute.
Why, please, ladies and gentlemen, players are ready. Thank you.
Well, all I can say is there can't be many fitter men at 39 than Jimmy Connors. And a slight delay still until we can somehow get the whole stadium settled down again. Fourth set. I'd love to know where the energy comes from, and so would Haarhuis. But that was quite a rally, that last, and so nearly dropping over for Connors. Well, I'm surprised anybody can hear anything like a let in all this din. So with that ace, he enters double figures. Well, it was out, but that is the way to lob defensively. High. One love, Haarhuis, in the fourth set. So there, the press box, the radio box is at the far end there, and the equivalent end, this end, our television boxes. Unforced errors, well, Haarhuis has committed more of late, and is catching Connors in that unenviable race. A race which often decides the outcome of a match, because most matches are lost rather than won. But I have to say that the quality of Connors' shot making and his ability to remain error-free when it really matters has been quite remarkable. Connors love one, fourth set, leading 2-1. But a much better attempt as a lob, that. It was at least high. Well, I don't know just how much more energy Collins has left in the tank. Must be high octane fuel that he's using. If you look at it this way, he's just over halfway to the total time that he spent on court against Quickstein. Well, Haarhuis has got to make some sort of effort on the Connors serve. He hasn't done a very good job in this game. But he's going to rescue this match, which at one stage, leading by a set and 5-4, it seemed would be his. I certainly thought so at the time. Wonderful control. A love game for Connors, just what he needed.
One game.
Well, Arthur Ashe has some urgent business. Those phones can be very annoying in the crowd, and often at tournaments they're asking, they ask people to turn off their phones and pagers because it puts people off so. And there's no question about it, Haarhuis has felt the weight of public opinion against him and public wish. Nay, indeed, a wild one. And although he has on this very court beaten John McEnroe and Boris Becker, and here this year also beaten Charlie Stabe. I suppose it would be expecting rather a lot for that golden run to continue. Well, Connors can hardly believe his luck. Here are three break points and they've been given to him. Converted three of the five he's had. That's better. So two saves. Another courageous forehand that was. But will he be able to shut out that noise? That's a great volley. It really is. Cool enough there. Yes, a careless forehand this time. Giving Connors another break point, his fourth. Break for Connors. Two under him in the fourth set.
Connors leads by 2-1.
Well, once again, he pumped himself up and the crowd, and that had its effect on Haarhuis, who in truth played some really wild shots to put himself in all that trouble, and then again, having got back to deuce, really hit a very foolish forehand, going for too much too soon. But really, what can you say? Connors finds inspiration and energy from who knows where, feeding off this crowd certainly, and living for them. I don't suppose there's ever been a greater character in these championships than this man. Playing here for the 21st time and his 113th match, 97-15. He is 13-9 this year in tournament play. And more figures for you. Connors' percentage of first serves in still a little lower than Haarhuis, but the percentage of points won when it goes in has overtaken Haarhuis, who earlier in the match was well ahead. Which suggests that A. Connors is serving a bit better and Haarhuis is returning now less well. Overcome, no doubt, by the occasion and the pressure of the crowd and Connors, who's hit some quite remarkable shots, particularly at the crucial moments, the secret or the sign of a great player. It's a wonderful smash because it was a fine lob. Not easy to hit a ball coming down vertically. Connors electing to bounce the smash. But it's still a difficult shot from there, really. The energy of the man, the sheer willpower driving him on is astonishing, isn't it? 2-1 with a break, 30 love. There haven't been many unforced errors of late. It's been a night of steady improvement for Connors, who took a set to run the stiffness out of him. And it's out. Willing it out, Connors. And the bemused gaze of a man who really doesn't know how to cope with all that's been thrown at him today. Some glorious tennis and accelerating progress by Connors, a glorious tennis in the past hour from him. And the noise and partisanship of this huge crowd. So everything now is being played at the dictate of Connors. He's directing the whole thing. Haarhuis has been consigned to a supporting role in this drama. Doesn't enjoy it, not one little bit. But frankly, one can only feel sorry for him because this man has been through it all before so many times. And for Haarhuis, a new experience, the first quarter-final ever in any Grand Slam. Quite honestly, I think he'd probably have preferred to play anybody else. Well, you look back on several moments in this match that have been turning points. In the first set, when Haarhuis led 4-love and 5-1, he failed at 5-2 to clinch it, lost his serve to 15, and that might have been an important moment if he'd kept Connors down, as it were. And then failing to win the second set when he served for it at 5-4. That was another moment of despair for him, for he began to choke and knew what it felt like for the arm to stiffen and the legs to freeze as Connors started to develop the momentum. And you can only feel sorrow when this whole baying crowd is crying for blood, and it's his blood. A total mishit, and the poor man in despair. His whole game beginning to fall apart now. Three break points. He's gone. Connors has got his man and knows it. 4-1 to Connors in the fourth set, leading by 2-1.
Connors lead by 4-1.
Well, this really is a quite extraordinary feat of endurance, of willpower, of technique. Let's not forget that, because he's hit some really glorious shots. And in fact, has it improved with each passing minute? You're looking at a man who knows not the meaning of defeat, because really defeat was staring him in the face. First in the first set, when he was really out of sorts, running the stiffness out of his legs, and then in the second, when Haarhuis served for it. But what a wonderful comeback. Just what he did first this year against Patrick McEnroe, and then in the previous round to this against Krikstein. And after that 4 hours, 41-minute match, I don't think anybody, certainly I didn't, think that it would be possible for him to recover in time to fight another battle as he's done tonight. But my goodness, it's the crowd, it's the willpower, and it's the effect on the opponent. Let's not forget poor Haarhuis, the Christian in the Colosseum facing the lion. And there will be an intriguing semi-final lineup if Connors completes this win, as now surely he's likely to. He plays, and I think that is the Duchess of York, if I'm not mistaken. I'm sure she'll be on the edge of her seat, as everybody else here is, at this extraordinary performance. Yes, he's gone, I'm afraid. Poor Haarhuis is drowning in a sea of emotion created by Connors.
White
4-1, 30 love, fourth set. Well, I don't think now Connors is going to let his man off the hook. He knows he's got him. He knows he's a better player. And he knows he has enough energy left now to finish this off. Look at this. Lovely and early. True as an arrow. And I started just now to speculate about the fascinating semi-final confrontation with Jim Courier, who earlier today beat the holder of the title, Pete Sampras. The old generation against the new. There he goes. Four more points. And one can only speculate on his feelings now, knowing that he had this match for the taking. If only he could have clinched the second set and taken a two sets to love lead. But the sheer weight of pressure has broken him. It would be an absolute miracle now if Haarhuis could turn this match around, and I can't see it happen. And whoever wins, we shall have a 24th unseeded semi-finalist at the US Open, and the 8th since Open tennis began. Last year it was John McEnroe who was the unseeded semi-finalist, and of course Sampras beat him. Connors, if he wins, and I'm sure he is going to now, he's going to have a huge jump in his ranking. He said he wants to go on playing for one more year. Well, if he reaches these semi-finals, as seems now certain, he'll jump around 30 spots to about number 70 in the world, because he's already assured of being about 100 from the present position of 174. So Haarhuis allowed a love service game, allowed because it was Connors who made the errors. He's ahead 5-2 and nearly home and dry. And as if to remind us where we are, an aircraft taking off from LaGuardia right overhead. Mayor Dinkins has done a wonderful job in giving us nearly a free run, a quiet time these past 2 weeks, but just once or twice we've had the dreaded noise. Well, what a wonderful performance it's been, this whole championship by Jimmy Connors, who has certainly been the story of these 1991 US Open Championships. The recovery against McEnroe, Patrick, that is, in round one, when he was down and out, recovering from Krikstein serving for the match against him in the previous round, and now doing it all again. and doing it for these New York fans who, over all the years he's been coming here, his 21 appearances have been fervent supporters of his style of street fighting play. They really love a scrapper here. Serving for a place in the semi-finals. So the nightmare continues for Haarhuis, whose game has just collapsed under the sheer weight of Connor's personality. Broken an extraordinary streak.
30-15.
When Connors won the fourth game of this set, he won 15 points in a row thereafter in winning it and getting to 30-love in this game. And that string of winning points broken. They came here to see their cherished hero do what he what seemed at one time impossible again, and he's keeping them on tender hooks to the last. Yes, the lob is long. Listen to this. Match point to Jimmy Connors. Well, I think some time ago, Haarhuis's resistance was snapped, and one can hardly be surprised, because really it is almost impossible to play here against Connors in this mood. That's it. He's done it.
Who's that to one? 4-6, 7-6, 6-4, 6-2.
Well, I never thought I would see another performance like that from Jimmy Connors, following on his extraordinary exploits against Crickstein a couple of days ago. But it just goes to show, with a great champion like this, you can never, ever underestimate him. 2 hours and 55 minutes he's lasted out here, and he looks as fresh now as when he started. In fact, a good deal fresher. He started rather slowly. So there it is. Jimmy Connors once more through to the semi-final of the championship. He's won five times. 4-6, 7-6, 6-4, 6-2. And a fascinating confrontation against Jim Courier.
That's just about it for another morning at the US Open. What an incredible story. Jimmy Connors at 39 through to the semi-finals, where he'll now face Jim Courier. It's ladies' semi-finals today. You'll see those live here on Sky Sports. Our coverage starts at 3 o'clock this afternoon. Hope you'll join me for that. Right now, from me and the team, good morning to you. Bye-bye.
Des Tages an, damit Sie das nochmal in der Übersicht haben, jetzt so um 18 Minuten vor 5 zu Hause. Und da sind Sie, Jim Courier, Pete Sampras, aber ja, 6-2, 7-6, 7-6, Lendelin-Strich 6-3, 3-6, 4-6, 7-6, 6-1, Connors gegen Haarhuis 4-6, 7-6, 6, 4-6, 2. Und da geht er, und das wollten wir auch nochmal anbieten, ist doch klar. Fantastisch, was er geleistet hat heute Abend hier in diesem Hexenkessel, der Jubel erbrandete noch einmal auf, und wir werden versuchen, ihn auch noch zu einem Interview zu überreden. Das wird allerdings noch lange, lange dauern, denn zunächst einmal kommt die internationale Presse dran, dann wird er für die gastgebende Fernsehanstalt, für die CBS noch ein Interview geben oder auch umgekehrt, und dann kommen wir vielleicht auch noch mal dran. Also es wird sich nicht lohnen, jetzt deshalb live hier auf Sendung zu bleiben, aber morgen hoffe ich, Ihnen das Ganze anbieten zu können, oder besser gesagt heute in unserem US Open Report um 16.50 Uhr. Also dann sollten Sie auf jeden Fall dabei sein. Eine Entscheidung ist heute auch schon gefallen, nämlich die im Mixed, und da wollen wir auch noch mal kurz auf die Tafel schauen. Oder ist das Programm von morgen jetzt gut? Sagen wir das Ihnen auch noch. Also ab 17 Uhr Steffi Graf gegen Martina Navratilova, Jennifer Capriati gegen Monika Seles. Ja, wann das so ganz genau sein wird, kann ich Ihnen auch nicht sagen. Auf jeden Fall werden wir das Ganze mischen mit unserer Sendung Anpfiff, mit Bundesliga-Fußball. Am besten, Sie bleiben morgen ab 17 Uhr bei RTL Plus. Und hier ist nochmal das Mixed-Ergebnis, das ich gerade mal angekündigt hatte. Ein niederländischer Sieg, wenigstens da. Bolle Graf Nijssen über Sanchez Vicario Sanchez aus Spanien. 6-2, 7-6. So, damit ist eigentlich alles gesagt. Es war ein langer, langer Tennistag mit hervorragendem Sport. Und wir sehen uns wieder morgen, heute, mein Gott, immer wieder dieser kleine Fehler, um 16.50 Uhr zum US Open Report, anschließend Steffi Graf und später dann Monika Seles. Ich hoffe, Sie sind wieder dabei. Gute Nacht, guten Morgen, einen schönen Tag wünschen wir Ihnen aus New York.